This is serious. So in most churches that I have passed through in my life in the ministry, by now few members will have donated generously enough funds to deposit for our church. But why are we having this spirit of self-doubt and faithlessness despite all the benefits we are getting on a daily basis from the Lord? And the fourth one is that change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but comes through continuous struggle. You cannot have change without struggle. And so we must straighten out our backs and work for our freedom. A man can't ride you unless your back is bent. We must understand that if we do not sow, we cannot reap. Many of us have developed an attitude of passive participation when it comes to displaying any role in the church.
Oh, yes.
We feel so comfortable without any aorta of conscience to reap where we have not sown, as if others can sacrifice their resources and get the job done. I will still benefit from their labor. But is that the meaning of brotherhood as taught by the man of God last Sunday?
No.
I should think not. All hands need to be on deck to move the church forward. This is the clear call to us all as the month of March is drawing fast to give this call our top priority and please God. I know some members have stopped coming to the church, while some will leave the church because of the token levy to signify our allegiance to the church of Christ. And loyalty to the dreams and mission of the church we call our own. I pray God to make a way for us and give us the hearts to give without counting the cost.
Amen.
Once you start today to try making that effort at discovering yourself, you will emerge powerfully and elegantly within you as you tap into your inner strength, as described in these words from Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint. And to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary. And the young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary.
Amen.
They shall walk and not faint. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you ready?
Amen.
To move to a new level of awareness?
Yes.
Are you ready? To move to a new level of consciousness?
Yes.
Recently, the person in this church said to me, "You know, Reverend, I've been attending this church for 6 years now. I have sat out in the congregation and I've listened to the messages and I've heard the lessons and I've participated in many different activities. But I have never applied the spiritual principles to myself and to my life." He said, I have heard something and I've said to myself, "Oh, isn't that beautiful? But I've never applied it to my own life." Then he said, "Now I am ready."
Amen.
So we are talking about some action here.
Amen.
Can we?
Hallelujah.
In order to reactivate our power of faith, we need to take action.
Amen.
So often, we read too much. I read too much myself. But some of us derive little benefit from all the things that we are reading. It's like a student who came to his class teacher with a question, with a problem that he wanted to share. He poured out his problem and the teacher said to him, "Well, I think this will help you. I know you've been studying, but I am not sure if you are really reading lessons in truth." "Yes." "Oh yes," he said. I've read Lessons in Truth. I've read scores of self-help books. I've read lots of metaphysical books, but none of them have helped me. The teacher looked at him gently and said, "Well, I think it might be a good idea to start again and start with Lessons in Truth. Start reading what you know about until you know it. As you are reading, a good idea is to come to something that you have to do and stop. Whether it is a change of attitude in you, whether it is a change of thoughts, whether it is a change of feeling, or some action, and then carry out that action before you proceed reading again. And then you can carry on reading again after that. But every time you come to something to do, do it. And then you not only know about it, you will know it. You will know it with the whole of your being. Don't be readers and hearers of God's words alone, but doers before we can be considered as useful vessels unto the Lord." Jesus said in John 19:17, "If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them."
Amen.
Amen. I find that it doesn't matter what it is done for me. I never gain full satisfaction until I'm able to apply those principles to my life. Isn't that true for you? It only comes from taking actions ourselves. A lot of us, we are so lazy that we want everything done for us. We feed us with the food of the Spirit. As soon as we go out, we forget, because next Sunday I'm coming to get another one. And I find it difficult myself. I don't get full satisfaction, but I'm able to apply those principles I've had to my own life.
Amen.
And it should be true of all of us. We can read about things. We can have people pray for us. We can talk with others about truth principles. But until we really apply them for ourselves, there is no fulfillment, no satisfaction, no glory, as joy comes out of active participation and achievement.
Amen.
Try today to be among the honorable list of achievers.
Hallelujah.
The religion of Jesus, I repeat again, the religion of Jesus is not for weaklings, not for the lazy people, and not for people of little faith.
Oh yes.
The teachings of God's people, church, are not for armchair religious people. They are not for Sunday only people.
Yes.
The teachings of Jesus require much from us. They promise much, but they also require much from us. They require that we practice the principles, that we forgive, and as we forgive, so we are forgiven. They require that we take time for prayer and meditation, that we set aside our doubts and fears, and that we move forward in the way that the Spirit of God within us is directing us.
Amen.
It's not enough to profess our faith. It's not enough to profess our faith. We have also to express our faith. And we express it through action, through activity. Abraham, the father of Israel, represents faith and obedience. Listen to what it says in Genesis 12:1-2. "And he set out, not knowing where he was to go, to receive the blessing from God." Faith is the foundational power of the 12 powers, which are the transforming agents with which you have been endowed, and one power of God within you. These powers are not something you have to get from somewhere. They are inherent within you as part of your inheritance of God. All the 12 powers are within you. You inherited them from God.
Yeah.
Charles Fillmore, in his seminal work, The 12 Powers of Man, identifies specific centers in the body which each acts as a kind of transformer to quicken that particular power into activity. The center for faith is the pineal gland in the center of the brain, just above the level with the eyes and the ears. If faith is so important, then you may ask, how then can I have faith? The scripture tells us in Romans 10:17, it reads consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. Here we come again asking ourselves, we are gospel church leaders. Why are we not seeing them at the church Bible study class on every Wednesday to assist them in being adequately equipped for the leadership position that Christ Jesus has placed them? Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And if you don't have faith, how can you function as a reliable leader? Belief is not the same as faith. Belief is the activator of faith. When you believe something, then faith is the power that brings that which you believe into visibility. Faith goes where your attention is centered. When you believe, your heart desires can be drawn to you, then your faith moves into expression. Faith is your ability to say, yes, God. Faith is your ability to draw your heart from the invisible to the visible. The belief and the faith of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in their God was so strong that they defied King Nebuchadnezzar and we are willing to die for their faith, as we have read in Daniel 3:8-29. How do we exercise our faith? How do you actively involve yourself in the process of drawing your goods from God? You do so by exercising your faith. See, Paul in this book, Your Power to Be, said faith can be defined and explained in enough ways to fill the books of a great library. But the one way to know what it is to put it to work. For as it says in James 2:26, faith without works is dead.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
It is significant that Jesus, in doing his healing work, always requires some action. Jesus always requires some action in doing his work. To the man with the withered hand, he said, stretch forth your hand. To the man who had lain by the pool of Bethesda for 38 years, waiting for someone to put him into the pool, he said, do you want to be healed? Then he said, take up your bed and walk. To the blind man whose eyes he had anointed with spittle and mud, Jesus said, go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. You remember the occasions when Jesus was on the shores of the Lake Genezareth. He was standing there and the people were gathered around him, so much so that he was raised against the lake, as we read in Luke 5. He looked around and he saw two boats there, one belonging to Simon, who became Simon Peter, and gave that to one of his friends. And Jesus asked Simon, put your boat out, jump a little way, and I get in. Then I speak to the people from there. Put your boat. And the other one, a little way, and I get inside it. Then I can speak to the people from there. The name Simon means hearing. The meaning of Simon means hearing, which represents receptivity. So he did what Jesus asked of him. And then Jesus spoke from the boat to all the people that were thronging around him on the shore. When Jesus had finished teaching, he said to Simon, "Now put out into the deep and let down your nets." This is the key note. Listen to it carefully. "Now put out into the deep and let down your nets." And Simon said to him, "Master, we have toiled all night, all to no avail. We did not catch anything, but at your word, I will let down my nets." So he put out into the deep, let down his net, and they were filled with so many fish that the nets were almost breaking. And he asked to call the other fishermen to come and help him with all the fish. The other fishermen were Andrew, Simon's brother and fishing partner, and James and John, sons of Zebedee. It was right at that point that Jesus said to them, to those four fishermen,